Everything okay?
Yeah.
Okay, so hi everybody, I'm Jordi Aguilar and I'm going to present you my work that it's called 2D-to-3D lifting of sign language poses. First, I will start with some motivation and introduction, then I will explain what is the task I'm working with, then the procedure that I followed, then the results that I have obtained, and finally, conclusions and further work. Okay, so first I want to start with this pipeline of the data modeling, data mining process. I'm going to explain it briefly. First, we start with the acquisition of data from an environment. Then we prepare this data so that we can work with it. Then we do some model that can feed this data and to finally obtain the results that we want and to evaluate these results and see if this meets our expectations. So what happens during all this pipeline is that the data potential decreases in each of the steps of this pipeline, because we of course assume that the models have limitations, models cannot achieve what we always want. We lose a bit of potential in each step of this pipeline. For example, when we acquire the data, the number of observations that we acquire reduces a bit the potential of the data. Then in the preparation step, if we don't prepare this data enough, if we don't do proper transformations, or if we don't filter this data, again, the potential decreases a little bit. And finally, if the model that we choose is not the right one, the potential decreases again, and this may lead that we don't meet the expectations that we have. So what can we do to try to keep this potential as high as possible is to fine-tune the model. So what we do is to try to do a better model in order to so that this model can squeeze all the information in the data. The problem is that, of course, this model has limitations, and these limitations are given by the data that it's in the input of this model. So in this project, we have focused in this step, in the preparation of the data. That is the step between the acquisition and the modeling part. This step requires understanding of the data and also a deep analysis of the data to know what we are working with. And the main goal is to try to propose an improvement to this data so that we ease the modeling, so that the model doesn't have to struggle that much to extract the information hidden in the data. How we do it? We can choose different steps, such as selection of features or also discarding some features that we think that they are not relevant for the model. Also doing some transformations. This can include preprocessing or also some sort of normalization. And finally, by integration. This last step means that we have to use other sources of data in order to enrich our data set, and this raises a bit the potential of the data, and the model can also extract more information about this data. So this is what we are going to focus on, and now let's present the task that we will be working with. We are working with sign language. I guess that everybody knows what sign language is, but basically it's a way of communication of the deaf community. Sign languages basically consist on movements of the hands and movements of the face to express sentences. Also, there are small movements, for example, of the body, tilting the body, and a lot of gestures also from the face. One of the main things that maybe we don't know is that there are a lot of different sign languages, just as there are different spoken languages. For example, there's Spanish sign language, American sign language, English sign language, and they are different, and the members of these communities cannot understand between them. And also, sign languages are not a literal translation of text or a literal translation of speech, but they have their own rules and their own way of constructing the sentences. And now, what about the research on sign language on generation of the sign language? We know for sure that with speech and with text, there are a lot of models that perform translation really well. We have models of speech generation that are currently used in a lot of applications, also of speech recognition. But with sign languages, we are not yet to this point to be able to translate, for example, sign language to text or to generate, for example, sign language, such that the synthesis of the sign language. So there's a lot of potential in this area. One of the reasons why this area is still growing is because there weren't decent data sets that enable us to do a lot of tasks. So one of the recent contributions to this area of research has been the How to Sign data set. It's a very large data set of American Sign Languages that basically includes a lot of different modalities. For example, from a given sentence, we have the speech signal. We also have the text. We also have the gloss annotations, that is like the translation of the movements of the sign language. And we also have the videos of signers performing these sentences. From these videos, we have extracted also the key points that correspond to the joints of the skeleton of the persons that are in this video. And for a small subset, we have also taken the 3D coordinates of these signers. This was done using a special studio with a dome and a lot of cameras. So this is the raw data that we're going to work with. So what are the challenges regarding preparation that this data offers to us? We have identified two, but there are many more. One could be the correction of the missing points and the misplaced points. This means that not the mechanisms to extract these key points are not always reliable. If there are occlusions or these sort of things, we don't retrieve the key point, and sometimes you have missing key points. And another aspect that would enrich our data is the 2D-to-3D lifting of the whole data set. As we have said, only a small fraction of this data set is in 3D, and the other is in 2D. So it would be really nice to have the whole data set in 3D, because this would enrich the data and at the end add another layer of information. In this project, we have focused in this one, that is the correction of missing and misplaced key points. So now we are going to explain the procedure that we have followed in order to accomplish that. And we must say that this procedure has been taken from this recent paper from these authors, and they have implemented in 2D skeletons, and we have used it to implement it with 3D skeletons. The first step of this procedure is the pruning. We want to erase skeletons with low confidence. These skeletons it might be said that each key point, also we have a confidence score that represents the sureness that we have that this key point is correct. And we want to erase these skeletons that doesn't have a lot of confidence because they may perturb the data. But of course, at the end, we don't want to have more missing key points. So we perform an interpolation to erase any missing key point and to try to have always a point that may be realistic. This interpolation is done by taking the mean of the neighbors of a particular frame. So for example, if in this case an orb is missing, we are going to do the mean of their neighbors, and we are going to retrieve the new key points that previously were missing. It must be said that the span of the neighbors depends on the confidence score that we have for each key point. So for example, if we know for sure that a key point is in place, we are barely going to do any meaning with any of the neighbors. But if we have a missing point and we know that this point has zero confidence, because of course it's missing, the length of the window will be big enough so that we can recover the key point. Another step is done to achieve consistency. Obviously, an invariant that these models have are the length of the skeletons. So basically what we do is to scale each bone so that they all have the same length. The problem is that we rely on the angles between the bones. So in order to find an intermediate solution between the reconstruction and the interpolation, we are going to try to optimize this formula to find a midpoint. The problem is that this formula needs some kind of regularization in order to find this midpoint. And we have two regularizations. The first one is the smoothness between frames. Okay, so we want that consecutive frames doesn't have a lot of difference. So frames that are very different from their neighbors are going to be corrected. And finally, we get a second regularization to try to keep the length of the bones that we have created in the previous step. So maybe the length of the bones is not rigid anymore, but at least they are not very different. This procedure ends here, and now we are going to show the results obtained by it. In this first case, we can see a skeleton with a lot of missing key points in the right hand. And after applying the preprocessing, we can see how we have recovered the right hand of this skeleton. Another case, for example, is this one. Here we are seeing the skeleton from above. We can see how the left hand probably is hidden from the camera, and we haven't been able to retrieve the key points. So after applying the preprocessing algorithm, we see how the skeletons have been reconstructed, basically from nothing, from missing key points. And now we can see how the hands are perpendicular to each other. And finally, one last example of only the hands in detail, we can see how the left hand, the third finger is really, really long, disproportionately long, and furthermore, the second finger is missing. So after applying the preprocessing algorithm, we saw how the third finger now has scaled to a natural size, and we have recovered the second finger. It must be said that the second finger in this example is a bit natural, but it is definitely more desirable than having a missing key point, and is definitely more realistic than having a hand with four fingers. Okay, so we have done a qualitative analysis of our results, and we see that, okay, they are more or less realistic, but can we do a quantitative analysis? How are we going to tackle this is by comparing the performance of the models. The first model is going to be trained with raw data, and the second model is going to be trained with the preprocessed data. Note that the data is not so different. At the end, there are a lot of key points that are in place, so we don't change them. But there are a lot of there are missing points that we have reconstructed. Once we have the models trained, we are going to evaluate them with clean data. We are going to see if there's much difference between the model trained with raw data and the model trained with the preprocessed data. The model, both models are equal, same architecture, same number of parameters. They are and they are simple because the purpose is not to the task that we are going to be evaluating is the 2D to 3D lifting. The input will be the X and Y coordinates, and the output will be the Z coordinate. The architecture of the model is an LSTM followed by a linear layer. This method exhibits an issue that is that if we define a sequence length between sequence length, the hidden state of the LSTM is reset. So at the end, we have multiple clips, but they don't have the span of a video. They have the span of the sequence length. In order to solve this problem between batches, we keep the hidden state of the LSTM. So all the clips can benefit from the previous clips. We train this model using L1 loss, also called mean absolute error loss, that we have seen that performs well when working with key points. And we are going to evaluate them using the percentage of correct key points, also known as PCK. Basically, it admits a key point that it a key point is correct if the prediction distance is within a threshold. This threshold is chosen by the fraction of a bone. The fraction is alpha, and the bone, in this case L, we have chosen to be the bone between the neck and the midhip. Okay, so now we plot the results. We see that while both models are almost equal, it is hard to understand which one is better with this graphic. But looking at the results, we saw that there is no improvement of the preprocessed model for small thresholds, but there is improvement for large thresholds. This means that if we set a threshold very, very constrained, the model trained with raw data performs better. And if the threshold is very large, the model trained with preprocessed data is better. What can we conclude from this? First, the preprocessed model has less variance because at the end, it's true that it doesn't perform better in closed thresholds, but it does perform better with large thresholds. And then we can also say that the model preprocessed with the model trained with raw data generalizes pretty well. This may be because there is fewer on data, also because the systematic behavior of wrong data, because all the three coordinates of missing points are equal. So at the end, predicting the Z coordinate, if X and Y are equal, and these are only the only points that this behavior happens, at the end, this is easy, and it's easy to split between wrong key points and good key points. Okay, so we have done these steps regarding preparation. We have shown that our model achieves realistic skeletons and that has less variance. What is the further work to do? Regarding preparation, of course, you can use the 2D to 3D lifting to achieve a whole data set, as we explained earlier. And there's a second also approach that is to find other representations rather than the X, Y, and Z coordinates in the Euclidean space. And finally, with this preparation, the further work to do is also to create the models able to finally achieve this synthesis of sign language from clear points and to achieve the text, the speech to sign synthesis, or the sign to text, for example, synthesis with the work, with the previous work done with the preparation of the data. So that has been all. Thanks a lot.
Moltes gràcies. Tenco la presentació, la gravació.